So far, we have seen about the introductory part of the application chemistry, in which we worked out the Z matrix and tested out the result visualization and those things. And in the next unit, we are going to see the important applications. This is very useful, which I am going to teach you now. And the application part, the first thing I am going to take is the structure activity relationship. And I think you are aware of the molecular descriptors that I was telling. So here I am sharing the screen. The descriptors we have seen included molecular descriptors. The use of the molecular descriptors will be discussed. And those which include polarizability, dipole moment, HOMO, LUMO, etc. And also very important is the log P. These descriptors are computable. Okay, computable. They can be computed using the softwares that are available. They give you the properties. Okay, so actually here it should be structure activity relationship and quantitative structure activity relationship, which we call as QSAR, collectively referred are mathematical models that can be used to predict the physicochemical, right? You can see physicochemical, physicochemical, biological, environmental, fate properties of compounds from the knowledge of their chemical structure. These models are available for free as common softwares. Okay. The use of QSAR has delivered reliable information that is comparable and sufficient to fulfill the information of the requirements. The QSAR has to be scientifically validated. And your substance has to fall within the applicability domain. I'm going to explain these terms. You have to make a note of that. As many other from, you should take care of all the data. You need to provide sufficient document to allow independent evaluation of the results. This is the basic definition which is taken from the internet, particularly Wikipedia. It has got very good definition. Now, I'm going to tell you what this QSAR is. Nothing. It's just a statistical model. What is a statistical model? Suppose if you bring a new drug, okay, develop a new drug. How do you test it? How to test it? In the present day, you know, we have got the COVID vaccine, right? For this vaccine, we've seen that there are clinical trials, in this clinical trial, you might have heard of a phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, etc. I think you have heard of that, right? What does these clinical trials mean? The clinical trials are actually a statistical way, statistical way. Well, what is that statistical way? Statistical way is, you will have, suppose, you know, I have a drug, okay. I say that it is anti-cancer. I'm not aware of the mechanism. Mechanism of action of drug. Okay. However, I have tested it to be, but it is successfully animals. So what we do initially is the drug is tested on 10 patients. Drug is given to 20 patients. The result is tested. Tested in patients. When the result is tested, you have to see that it comes to more than 70%. 70%. There are about, for example, roughly speaking, if out of the 20 patients, 14 patients succeed. 14 patients succeed, then it is a good drug. We are not bothered about the 30%. Some people take it as 60% success and 40% failure. So this is the statistics. Out of the 20 patients, 14 patients come out successfully. 6 patients may die, but still you say that because it is more than 60%, the drug is very good, and then you bring it to the market. Bring it to the market. So this is called as the entire thing, that the process now that we did. You call it as a kind of model. What is that model? What kind of patients you are taking? What kind of disease you are addressing? What is the drug you are taking? All these details you discuss in numbers. You discuss in numbers. That is called as the statistical model. Okay. Now the statistical model has been successful. But it's not very accurate. Not accurate. Why it is not accurate? Because it is like a trial method. Trial and error. Error method. Now it is for this reason you study in MPhil, you know, you study statistical method. Statistical methods in MPhil. In these statistical methods, you will have several factors, like for example, average, mean deviation, standard deviation, and regression, constant. I suggest you remember this. This is going to be very useful to your regression constant talk. And this is what is having its root in, this is what is having roots in Hammett equation. Hammett equation. Log k by k0 equal to sigma and rho. Well, this you might have studied detail in Jerry Mott's book. Organic chemistry. When it comes to you, don't just ignore it. Find out what it addresses. It has got several band addressing during our MSc. We just ignored this because there was no thing like, for example, direct application of these things were not discussed in the book, and we were simply not aware of what it was going to do. But let me tell you what it actually does. This K is actually a rate. I think you know k equal to 2.303, etc. Okay, that rate k for that particular reaction. Okay, k0, you know, it stands for standard conditions. What is the standard condition? You carry out certain reactions at STP and then you call it as the standard condition. It often changes. The conditions are not always standard. The pH changes, the reactivity under certain pressure changes, the atmospheric pressure, temperature changes, all these things will change, the reaction will change. So the rate of the reaction under standard condition and the rate of the reaction under axial condition are just taken up to the logarithmic values, and they are initially, you know, in fact, you know, this can be a constant proportional to rho. You can put it as a proportional to rho. Rho is a kind of a reaction constant. What is a reaction constant? What is a reaction constant? Can you tell me any reaction constant? Reaction constant is, you might have done so many, for example, preparation of an organic compound. Preparation of an organic compound. You do that, these preparations are done in the laboratory. When you do this, those preparations in the lab, you take up the chemicals required, okay? Then mixing proportions, mixing moles, and then the heating techniques, the cooling techniques, and the proportions in which you are going to make, all these things are different, okay? That is why you have a procedure. It is not that you just take the A plus B, simply mix it, and you get C plus D. It's not like that. You have to calculate moles, you have to increase the temperature, you have to reduce it to the room temperature. Sometimes you have to reduce the pressure, sometimes you have to add acid, sometimes you have to add base, sometimes you have to add catalysis. Okay. So under these conditions, yes, this keep on changing. Okay. So what Hammett equation did is, this is the equation that you have. Here are the some things, you know, what the equation is meaning. I'm going to have a particular compound called as this benzene, in which I'm just taking up the R. Okay, this R, I'm just taking it as a substitute at this particular place. So you can see that I'm changing R from H to CH3 to ethyl to isopropyl to tertiary butyl to benzyl to phenyl. So I'm just substituting all these things, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7, okay. So I prepare 7 derivatives in the table, and then what I do, calculate the energy. Okay. I think you know how we got this energy of formation, energy of formation, or enthalpy. We got all these things in our in our computational chemistry using MOPAC and the GEMS. Okay, so energy can be computed, and then you can see that some energy that you have already something like 100 or something like 1000, you just take it as a standard. Okay, tetramethylsilane in NMR spectroscopy is taken as a standard because it comes in the upfield and it is highly shielded. Okay, it's shielded or deshielded? Deshielded. Aromatic protons are upfield, and this non-aromatic protons are upfield. Okay, so that TMS in NMR you are taking as a standard. Here also you take something as standard, and then see that the energy keeps on changing from 1.24 to minus 0.7 to minus 2.25. It keeps on changing. Okay. Then what is this particular factor? This is sigma. This is a it's a kind of parameter. What could be the parameter? The parameter could be log P. It could be the band gap. Or it could be the polarizability, or it could be nucleophilicity, or it could be electrophilicity. Okay, these are all can be calculated using FMO methods. FMO is the frontier molecular orbital theory. In the frontier molecular orbital theory, you always take up this homo-lumo gap, okay, highest occupied molecular orbital minus lowest unoccupied molecular orbital, and the orbitals are there in the output. And taking these orbitals, you can always put up the orbitals, I mean, you can always put up the energy difference and a subtraction. For example, ionization potential, I can put it as N, equal to HOMO minus LUMO by 2. Ionization potential I am going to get directly by substituting the values in electron volts. This is value in electron volts, by 2. I just get the this is not new, this mu is ionization potential, and then you have got electron affinity, and then you have hardness. I think you know Pearson's soft and hard basis principle, hardness and softness. Okay, this is you know 1 minus 2 eta, right? Will give you the softness. Okay, softness means you know that is softness means you know reactive molecule. Okay, hardness it presents you know resistivity to change. Resist change agar change will not change will resist. So that is what you call as the hardness. So these values you know you can be you can see that from the theta values you are going to get 1 minus 2 eta as a formula, you get the softness, and just opposite of the softness is the hardness. You can have 1 minus softness as equal to hardness. Okay, so there are these things you know which can tell you the molecular descriptors, and I can give you the parameters there. So you can choose, you know, this actually requires a very good knowledge of chemistry. Knowledge of chemistry. How? If I am taking aroundings, I must be aware of the different factors like the inductive effect, plus A effect, minus A effect, R effect. All those effect, if I just substitute, I get a very good value. And then what I do is, I am able to draw a graph. Okay. And then when I'm drawing a graph, I get this. So let me show you one graph that is there. Here it is. The Hammett parameters is a type of linear free energy relationship. Free energy, you know, I think you know we got so much amount of free energy calculation. So I bet theoretical calculation of free energy is the best way to predict quickly the energy relationship. That is the energy processed by that. We have seen in the output the core repulsion energy, core attraction energy. Also. This is designed to model the electronic effect. What is the electronic effect? Electronic effect means you know it should be inductive. You have studied in your first year mesomeric effect, resonance effect, anomeric effect. Okay, and here you have M. Mesomeric means plus M, minus M, plus I, minus I, plus R, minus R, anomeric, so many effects are there. So that effect is what you are going to see here. When you substitute here with NO2, what happens to this energy? When you substitute here with NH2, what happens to this energy? When you substitute here with, for example, CH3 or OCH3 is a very good electron donating group, what happens to this free energy? So many amount of substitutions you are taking to a particular organic particle. Here in this case, it is CH5, COOH, it's benzoic acid. So they have taken the benzoic acid and tried to find the electronic effect of the substituents and aromatics in the para and meta positions only. So information gathered can be used for the mechanism of the reaction and can be applied to optimization of reaction conditions. So here you can see that this is the reactions, and you cannot just take up any parameter and put it to the reaction. Before going for any reaction, you study all the history of that particular reactions and take up all the references. That is what is being discussed in this. You should have a knowledge of this. Okay. So you see that there is a creation of cation plus H2O plus there, and while changing from methoxy to methane to hydrogen to chloride to nitric oxide, The pKa value is keeping on changing from 4.47 to 4.36 to 3.99 to 3.44. And you can see the lowest value is given by 3.99, okay, for the chloride derivative. That means chlorine is an electronegative atom. It quickly, you know, chlorine is an electronegative atom. If it attracts electron, these electrons are attracted here, this will go here. So quickly you can have your minus charge there. And then this is the factor that you are going to substitute here in the Hammett equation. Okay. So the sigma and rho are not something when we studied sigma and rho were very, very different. We thought sigma is something which is not in our hand, rho is not something which is not in our hand. It's not like that. It's a condition put forward by you. You know the reaction conditions, you know the reagents you are taking, you know what you want to get, you put out certain parameters. The procedure is like this, and the parameters are in the sigma. Okay. The sigma is those parameters. For example, I can just, rather than going for all the changes, I can fix it as P, temperature. And even I can put it a constant. I'm not going to change the temperature. I'm just going to see what happens to the overall reaction conditions. So K0 and KU is, you have already done how you, in the physical chemistry in the third year, you have already done how to the K0 is calculated and how K1 is calculated. Okay, you can take zero order reaction, you can take any reaction which is just a standard conditions. Okay, so like that, is somebody writing there? So like that, the methods can substitute it. Computationally, you can compute these things. Can compute these things and get the results, and the reaction can be applied and the optimization of reaction conditions. Okay, so these values, you know, you have to, here you have just taken only 7 derivatives. Okay, the QSR requires at least 40 derivatives for any model to be very successful. You have to use a large amount of data, particularly, you know, just by telling 2 or 3 incidents, you cannot say that this is a very good case. You have to prove with enough examples, and you have to have sufficient data. It is always the case with so many things in our life. Okay, so I'm going to add another image and just show you. What happens to the, what is the thing that is there in the Hammett equation, right? Here you can see, you get a very good plot finally. What is the plot? This value, P is K versus derivatives. Okay. In plot A, the slope sigma indicates the electron donating substituents facilitate the reaction. Okay. So graph is there. I'll just import the graph. I think that is a graph there. The graph is missing. Let's see the graph. You will get a graph like this. Okay, I am exporting the graph again to just tell you. The graphs are very useful, actually. 3 is a very good graph. Here you can see, you will get a graph like this. Can you see this? You see a graph there? Here it is. Right? So this is the graph you are getting. You already drawn certain graphs there. So this particular reaction with respect to the Hammett plus is being discussed, and I am going to just tell you this in plot A, the slope rho indicates the electron donating substituent facilitates the reaction. That means, you know, electron withdrawing substituents, if you have withdrawing substituents means, you know, it is opposite. They will not facilitate opposite of that. Okay. The electron donating substituents, paneling would make the hydrogen more nucleophilic. It's a very important point. Electron donating substituents and paraniline would make the nitrogen more nucleophilic, including the DAC. This is a substituent name, is acting as electrophile, and the reaction is undergoing electrophilic accretion mechanism, part B. In plot B, the slope C indicates that electron withdrawing group facilitated. Here, electron withdrawing. You see the difference between these two? Okay, facilitates the reaction, making nitrogen ion more electrophilic. Here it is more nucleophilic, here it is more electrophilic. So you just keep on the changing. Okay, so in, that is the final outcome. You should have at least a minimum of 50 derivatives to suggest this particular thing. Otherwise, you cannot say. In order to plot Hammett to correlate well with the sigma plus plus, these are all some plus or minus. This is electrophilicity and electro. Or nucleophilicity, there must be some charge resonance involved because of the sigma plot quality. There is a little no charge resonance at the transient state. So you can study the transient state also. Okay. So finally, what I am going to conclude here is the things we have discussed is the reactivity pattern can be obtained. Reactivity pattern can be obtained. What is the reactivity pattern? If you have an aromatic substituent, if you change R, what will happen if you keep changing R? Changing it from electrophile to nucleophile. Okay. The best results are given by Hammett-Taft equation, where log K by K0 equal to sigma into rho. Okay, this is the Hammett equation. And in computational chemistry, what we do is we take up this as the molecular descriptors. Molecular descriptors. What are these molecular descriptors? The molecular descriptors include polarizability, HOMO values, LUMO values, electrophilicity. It can be calculated computing electrophilicity, and then ionization potential, ionization potential, electron affinity, and then log P. Log P is the distribution coefficient. It is actually a distribution coefficient. You have done it in the third year physical chemistry, distribution coefficient. Like that, the molecular descriptors are out, there are about 2000 descriptors in chemistry. Like, for example, surface area, surface volume, van der Waals constant. So many things are there. We are not having so much amount of knowledge there. But we just can limit ourselves to a very few descriptors, and then we can take up any reaction. Like, for example, I have taken C6H5R. Substitute R. What are the R values? R values will be CH3, Cl, it may be F, it may be NO2, it may be NH2, it may be NCH2, NCH3 twice, it may be NH2, NO2 is already given, and it may be OCH3, COOH, and COOR. Keep on here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Here you are getting 10. Plus 10 more substituents. Calculate energy, okay, calculate energy, and then come to a conclusion using graph. An example of that conclusion is given here. What is that example? The plot A. In plot A, you can see the slope P indicates the electron donating substituents facilitated the reaction. Electron donating substituents of paraniline would make the nitrogen nucleophilic, whereas electron withdrawing group facilitated the reaction, making the nitrogen more electrophilic. So you can get both electrophilic and nucleophilic by just taking the reaction. Okay. So it is asking me to stop here and just stopping this share. And if you have any doubts, you can please ask me. You can end up there. So whenever you get a chance, you look into the Hammett-Tufte equation. Just make yourself sure that it is only this Hammett-Tufte equation that has increased the scope of all the reactivity. Transition state, that is what you have seen in the kinetics, the transition state, the excited state, the calibration of different orbitals, the reaction speed, the reaction rate, stability, all these things you can calculate using the Hammett-Tufte equation. Okay,